Yes, thank you. So welcome at our lunch lecture, which is going to be about how we use data in complex projects. But before we go into the subject, we will first introduce ourselves. So my name is Sander Winkel. I work at Counter Cooper as a system integrator, which basically means that you connect different applications with each other. But my background is not in IT or anything like that. I have a background in hydraulic engineering at the TU Delft, where I also worked part-time at the TU Delft to integrate digital education, building information models and things like that. And also in September 2017, I started working part-time at Counter Cooper till 2019. And now since a year ago, I returned full-time in my current position as a system integrator. Yeah, but he doesn't have a microphone because there were only two microphones, so I will introduce him. But I think some people already know Niels. He's studying here and he is currently working at Counter Cooper as a part-time employee. Basically the same thing as I did. Before that, he was an intern and worked on the chatbot. And he's going to tell something about that at the end of our presentation. But first, something about Counter Cooper, because I can imagine that you don't know Counter Cooper, because we're quite a small company. We're currently with 65 full-time employees. We were founded in 2013, so that's actually not that old yet. And to give you a perspective of how fast we are growing, in 2017, when I started there, there were only 23 people. So that's quite a lot of growth in the last years. And that's mainly because our business is winning tenders. And if you win tenders, you also need to execute them. So you need people for that. What differs us from a normal project management firm is we don't send people to a client. You always work in a team. So you're never the only Counter Cooper colleague on a project. You're always together with someone else. Often it's 5 or 6 people. So the projects we do, I think this is more familiar to you. This is the Central Square before Amsterdam Central Station. We do that together with Max Beugel, who is a contractor. So Max Beugel has the equipment and the material to build it. And then we come in as the project management to do the project controls. And actually, the project manager of the entree currently is a full-time employee of Counter Cooper. So you can see that you always work in an integrated team with also people from different companies. Then another project is the Kademuren project in Amsterdam. Maybe if you followed the news, you saw that the K-walls in Amsterdam are quite weak and are collapsing sometimes even. So that's quite a big challenge for the municipality of Amsterdam to renovate them. And they're actually doing that with 3 different consortia. And we are in there as one of the consortia partners of together with Bains. And then the final project, which will go on further on in this presentation, is the A9 project, which is one of the largest infrastructure projects currently. It's 800 million euros, so that's a massive project. I'm on that project part-time basis. Jelle is there full-time. So that's also, because it's such a large project, we get quite a lot of opportunities to experiment with digitization and to get the construction industry a step further, because basically the construction industry is one of the least digitized sectors in the world. So there's a lot of room for improvement. But also you can imagine that for such a large project, it's quite complex to do that. You work in quite a large team. Quite a lot of people are in there. And basically what you see is that the complexity is increasing. And before we go into the topic, I want to conclude with this quote from Stephen Hawking, who said at the beginning of the century is that he thought that this will be the century of complexity. So now Jelle is going to tell something about complexity and how it's increasing.
Yes, So as Sanne already said, complexity is increasing in projects. And why is it happening? We are currently building a lot of magnificent buildings and a lot of magnificent structures around the world. And what comes along with that is that it also increases the technical complexity. We have some examples behind us here, the Louvre in Abu Dhabi, as well as, for example, the large airport in Mexico City. Well, along with the increase in technical complexity, we also have an increase in the number of parties that are involved in creating such a project. More parties mean often larger organizations and also more people who have to be managed and who have to be looked after during executing a project. And what's also happening is that we are expected to work better, faster, and cheaper. And what is the effect of that? We have an increase in the chance of errors because complexity is increasing and our projects are getting larger. But what's also happening is that our margin of errors is decreasing. We have to work better. We have less room for delays, less room for cost overruns, and that makes everything a lot more difficult. Just to give you a look of what complexity looks like in practice, we've made a small comparison. We have Ask News about a project that you've all probably done, and we're going to compare that to the largest project that we have, which is the A9 project. Well, when you look at duration, your project would last around 12 weeks, while a large infrastructure project like the A9 can last, in this case, around 6 years, if we finish it on time. Then when we look at the number of internal teams, in your case, and with your student project, there is none because you are the only team. At such a large project, you will have a lot of different internal teams. In our case, it's 12, and all those 12 teams have to communicate with each other. Then when we look at the size, a normal project group is around 5 to 6 people, and we have over 800 people working in our organization. And last but not least, we have subcontractors. In a normal student project, you're the one who is doing all the work, at least I hope so. And in such a large project, we have around 60 other parties that are involved that are doing some work for us, which we also have to manage and look after. Then, to make it a bit more visual, instead of just a table, we visualize the following. What you see here are a work package on the left, a object in the middle, and a person within our organization on the right. And what we've tried to visualize here are all the relations that can be made to a work package, which is displayed here, to an object, displayed here, and for the organization part, the green dot in the middle is someone within our organization. As you can see, there are a lot of relations to different aspects, and all these aspects have to be looked after and have to be managed. As you can see with the work package as well as with the object, this becomes one cloud of different things that have to be managed. But when you think about looking at just one single work package, which you see here, and when you think about that we have around 2,000 to 3,000 work packages that have to be managed within a project, and more than 1,000 objects that have to be managed within a project, you might be able to think, okay, we're not able to do that just manually and by talking to each other. And just to give a practical example, we have a person in our organization who's called the configuration manager and who looks after our work packages. And just to give a small indication of what a work package is a package of activities that we have to execute to create a part of our project, in this case, the work. Well, as I said before, those activities have to be executed, so they have to be planned. So a configuration manager who looks after those work packages has to talk to a planner. But the planner does not know as much about those work packages as our configuration manager. And as you can see, there's a gap of knowledge. And this has to be communicated correctly. But because the complexity is going to be that large, there's a large chance that it isn't communicated in the correct manner or in full. So as a result, the planner's going to decide for himself what that missing gap of knowledge should be. And that's where problems and errors arise. And you want to minimize those as much as possible. So how do we deal with that? Projects are mostly based on people executing processes. In this case, a configuration manager who talks to a planner who has to install those work packages in the planning. And what we try to do is we try to facilitate executing all those processes as correct as possible by using technology. And about how we do that, Sanne is going to talk about that right now.
How are we working with complexity actually in practice? So we're going to look at one of the key processes on a project, and that is the risk process. Probably some of you have already heard of risk management and things like that, but basically a risk is someone who identifies a problem with the project that might occur or might not. So that must be registered in a system. So that's no problem. What we then do is, from that system, we will create a dashboard with a nice overview of all the risks that are in there, the control measures that are there, that are the measures that are being made to mitigate the risk or try to keep the impact as low as possible. And basically, from the dashboard, the risk coordinator or any person on the project knows what he needs to do to mitigate or at least to execute the actions to get the risks as low as possible. So, like Jelle just showed you, we are working in the technology domain. We believe that technology is an enabler between the people and the processes. So that's basically the middle part. That's the technology domain. But now you might think, okay, it's being registered in a system. Why don't we just look in the system directly? Why don't we do that? So I will show you a screenshot of our risk register actually from the A9 project that looks like this. There's quite a lot of information in there, and it's not really a great overview to do your work. Basically, the risks of all the people on the project are in here, and these are only 6 risks. So that's not even everything. But how much risk are there on such large projects? How much do we currently have? So at the moment, there are more than 500 risks active on the project. So if you go back to this, these are 6. So imagine this table with more than 500 risks in there. That will become quite a difficult overview to get your information and get your actions. But risk is not the only thing we have. Jelle already talked about work packages. There are almost 2,500 of those. So imagine, again, those work packages with all the relations Jelle just showed you. It gets quite complex to manage that and to understand what's actually happening on the project. But we are a project management firm, and we want to control the project. So basically, our task is to understand the complexity and the relations and how things affect each other. But then we also have the activities. Those are the planning rules. So what's actually going to be executed outside? We have over 5,000 of those. And the activities are related to the work packages again. The risks are related to the work packages. So you can already see the relations going in here. But then we also have documents in there. And the risks and the work packages, we control those in a dedicated system with all the information. But imagine if those are also in documents, then we would have many more than 24,000 documents. The documents that are in there are currently mostly design documents, like drawings of the roads and bridges and how things are being designed, how we're going to prove to Rijkswaterstaat, the client, that the things are actually being done according to the requirements they specify. But imagine if we all also create Excel sheets for risks. It gets complex quite quickly. So to get one layer practical, okay, what do we actually do on the project to give the people on the project the insights to know how they must manage their processes and keep in control? Because basically, that's our main goal. We want to maintain control over the project and what's happening there. So we're going to get a little bit technical about the work breakdown structure and the planning and the relations. So basically, the work packages are the things that must be executed outside, and the things we must show to the client: look, it is completed, please pay us. Those are in the planning. So there's two different systems over there. You can forget the names, but the one from the work breakdown structure is called Relatix, and the planning we do in Primavera. So you might think, okay, that's quite easy. We're just going to link the systems. Like, you're a system integrator, let's link it up. Unfortunately, due to licensing issues and the programs being separated, that's not possible. So you can see here, okay, we need to come up with a different solution to be able to give the planner in this case and the configuration manager the insights in their process. Because you want a direct relationship between the systems, the work breakdown structure and the planning must be aligned with each other to actually know what's happening outside and to control the project and execute it. So to do that, we developed something we call the WBS checker, a WBS sanity check. And basically what we do, at the moment the planner uploads a new version of his planning to our system, we're going to automatically check it with the work breakdown structure in Relatix. And after about a half an hour, he gets a nice email in his inbox with the report and the result of that. So this one is from the 26th of November, if I remembered correctly. And what you can see there somewhere, it says the matching rate is about 92%. So 92% of the work packages that are in the planning are also the same in Relatix. So you can see that here the technology enables the planner to know that he is actually aligned with the planning. And he still needs to do some work. But to indicate where we came from, when we started this, we were at 24%. 24% of the items in the planning were the same as in Relatix. Whereas in Relatix, we manage the things with the contract and the clients. So that's basically how we determine if we should get paid and show to the client that things are being done. But the planning is what's actually happening outside. So it's quite an important process in a project that those things are aligned. So you can see here that due to the increase, the technology is really enabling the planner and the configuration manager to align their processes with each other. Because the technology is not directly solving anything here. It just reports to them how much aligned they are, how much of your planning is correct with Relatix. And based on that, it suggests actions, but then to the planner and the configuration manager to go into a conversation and to think, okay, who needs to change what? How are we going to do that? So you can see this is a good example of how the technology enables the people and the processes.
Yes, as Sun already said, it's important that all your work packages are present in your planning so that you can execute them. But planning is not only including everything, but also having structure. Thank you. And having the right follow-up of activities. And we took a page out of the book of the US military. Because as you might understand, the US military large organization has a lot of projects, part of the army to country. Successful in what they're trying to do with the consequences that happen when they don't. So to check that, we use the following, which is the DCMA 14 points schedule assessment, which, as the name already says, gives you 14 different points on which you can assess if your planning, or in this case, is structurally and technically sound. And we do that using our data. So what do we actually do? We have our planning in our system called Primavera. We take all our planning information out of that system and into the cloud. There we make the data ready for use. And based on that, we create an interactive dashboard and a report, which we can then communicate towards the people who are working on the planning and towards management of the project, so that they know what the current status is and where we can improve. What does this dashboard and report look like? it is as you see here behind me, it's very comparable to how you would normally score a, for example, an exam. You have your report score, in this case, 6.4. You would get the points, not that great, but it's sufficient. And we create that based on these aspects. And these are the 14 points that are used to check if the planning is technically sound. Based on that, we do a pass or fail check, which you can see here, and that produces our report, along with some actions that the planners can take to improve their planning. So we also try to help them see how they are able to improve. Which brings us to the main takeaway of this entire story, and that is the following. You should think of a number of people, for example, a configuration manager and a planner, executing certain processes, in this case, creating a rigid planning. And we should use technology and data to facilitate them doing that as well as possible. So none are replaceable and all are needed to make a sound and executable project and to make your processes executable as possible. So we've talked about what we've done, and now we're going to focus on what we're going to do.
Thank you. Does it work? Yeah, great. Okay, what's next for us? And that's kind of where I come in. As of September, it was part of Cooper as an intern, and I did an assignment on creating a chatbot, which I've just finished recently. And within that assignment, we actually started to look at the viability of implementing a chatbot with the company and seeing how it can be of beneficial use for all. And that in the following question, we can benefit from it. Which might be the biggest benefit, but can of other people of their additional work. Just to get an idea for you, to give you an idea about what we kind of mean with implementing a chatbot. Here we see some examples. First, it's kind of a dumb one actually, because it's just a personalized form, and it does the work for a service employee. It just asks you questions, that provides that information, service employee, which actually helps. Nothing. And Billy is actually handling 45% of interactions between customers and bol.com without having human intervention. How does it do that? Billy makes clever use of databases and different kinds of sources of information. And of course, that's something that really sparked our interest as well. So we wanted to give her on that kind of chatbot. Let's reflect on this slide. We've seen it. Where the chatbot can come in. And I'll explain a very abstract form of access to all the construction worker needs a combination of planning and it needs a combination of work packages, for example. It's two different systems, but he doesn't know how to combine them because they don't link. He has a question, but he can't solve it himself. He then sends an email to one who has access. That person might not see it initially, so it takes some time. Here we have a delay. The person has to figure out the answer to the question, which takes time of another person as well, and then send a message back. This, once again, could happen with a delay because he might not see the message initially. So we're spending quite a lot of time just to answer a question based on our data. That's something, of course, that we want to make more efficient. Just with the chat question, you ask it, you get your response immediately. And this is, of course, very beneficial for us, company. It has three main advantages. Firstly, it's all about the reduction of communication error. We've seen the scale of complexity of a project. You can imagine if so things are going another, there is some this may be not copied correctly. This is a system which tends to mean mistakes. Systems. These are employees. Have sets of data. It in, but also structuring it, generalizing it, standardizing it, and you can make in later stages of are going high project complexity. Other and if explain this. We can actually gain insight in the questions that our employees have. So we can see where are the questions, so where is there uncertainty, or where do people do not know where to find information, or what things are unclear. And based on that, we can improve our information structure and our information. These were kind of the findings of the internship research. What did that an actual work type of Cocoa, which was able to combine different sources of data answers such data. And how did we test this? Our company invited 20 of our colleagues where we did a session today, were given images. These were conducted by one group who was able to make use of the chatbot. Group was just able to use the traditional. We compared the time, and the chatbot was faster 4 out of 5 times. So at that point, we achieved the result that we wanted to. That kind of sums it up. That was also an internship. I decided together to new work at the Cooper.
Give the perfect view. And the full-fledged chatbot, as you said, is part of a larger development we want to embark on. And that's, we talked a lot about everything is in different systems, and not everything can be linked with each other. And furthermore, you can also imagine that if you're on the project and you're trying to think, okay, I need to access this information, where is it? Where can I find it? So basically what we want to do is we want to create one central portal platform where you can just go in the morning and see all the things you need to do. So where you have all your project-related work, but also the things you need to do for Counter Cooper. So everything is in one platform, which in the lower left corner you can see Cocoa is integrated there. So the chatbot is integrated into our platform. So even if you can't find it on the platform, you can just ask Cocoa and ask, okay, I need this information, where can I find it? What we want to do here is we want to make it easier for everyone on the project to get the information they need to do their job and to control the project, but also we want to make it easier to report risks, deviations, issues, things that are happening outside, because that kind of information is important to know how the project is actually going. But also, I just a few slides back, I showed you how the system looked. It's not really clear and not quite a good overview of what's actually happening, because there's also a lot of stuff that you're not even responsible for. And what we also hope with our own platform is that we can create a personal overview. You log in, you see the things you need to do and how your tasks are dependent on others and the dependencies you have with others. How does your work relate to the construction of the highway? So this is basically what we want to aim for at the end of next year. We hope we can come back here and show you COCO live in our platform, that it actually works. And that's quite a big challenge for us. So that's why I want to conclude with this slide from Steve Jobs, which basically became the mantra of our team. The people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. Like, if we really believe that this can be a change for the construction industry, so we just need to do it. For that, we also need more people. So if you are looking for something just like news, to work with us part-time at an internship, maybe a graduation project, you can scan this code, leave behind your contact information, and we'll get into touch with you to see if there's something where we can make a match. Thank you for your attention. Are there any questions?